Hello, me and Woola here are here to review the Warlord of Mars. Well, probably I'm here to review the Warlord of Mars. The Warlord of Mars, it's the third in the Barsoom series, which I have been reading along with the fellows at Marsathon. Third of the Barsoom novels, where John Carter, a Virginian gentleman, goes to Mars through many kind of sort of magical means, gets deeply in love with Dejah Thoris, one of the red, beautiful red Martian woman, makes friend with the green Martians. In the last book, has to battle the white Therns and the black firstborn Martians, destroying all their gods in the process. Dejah Thoris and Thuvia, another red Martian, are imprisoned in the Temple of Sun with Fedor, one of the a icy cold, beautiful but terribly cruel white Thern, who also is of course in love with John Carter. And where as the Temple of the Sun, which will keep them in prison for a year, is slowly shutting, Fedor lunges with a dagger to kill Dejah Thoris, because then, once Dejah Thoris is dead, John Carter will have no choice but to love her and only her. The doors slam shut, and that is the cliffhanger, which we are hoping will immediately get answered as we open up the Warlord of Mars. Of course, what we find is no, 6 months have gone by, they're still trapped in there. But John Carter of Mars has got an idea, because one of the fallen goddess Isis's followers, Thurid, black Martian, it seems to be sneaking out every once in a while, and is maybe meeting up with the fallen but still at large white Thern leader, Mattai Shang, the holy Hecador. John Carter and the father of Tuvia, the other red Martian maid who had been trapped and who has been swept up in all this kidnapping, are able to make their way through, infiltrate into the yellow Martians, where we have more daring battles, more great sword fights, all the stuff that you kind of come to expect from these books, where just difficulty after difficulty after difficulty gets pounded on John Carter of Mars. And it's one of these things where you get all these great speeches. You get Mattai Shang saying, "But that the death you die tonight," John is talking to John Carter, obviously, "but the death that you die tonight shall be maybe doubly bitter. Know that when you have passed, your widow becomes the wife of Mattai Shang, Hecador of the Holy Therns, for a Martian year. And at the end of that time, as you know, she shall be discarded, as is the law amongst us, but not, as is usual, to lead a quiet and honored life as a high priestess in some hallowed shrine. Instead, Dejah Thoris, Princess of Helium, shall become the plaything of my lieutenants, and perhaps of thy most hated enemy, Thurid the Black Dactor." Which we get, th th this is sort of where we get into the thing of Dejah Thoris is very much the princess in peril here. There's a lot made that, like, oh, there she's strong and capable and all this stuff, but women on Mars are not allowed to learn the martial arts, so she's not allowed to defend herself. She's the engine that she's that object that John Carter is always kind of reaching out for. And if you can kind of see these pulp novels as sort of it's the pop dream of the time, and this is very much a male pop dream of, like, oh, this is something that's just out of reach in your dreams. It's just out of reach, and I can almost get it, but oh, Edgar Rice Burroughs is always throwing stuff at his heroes to just make sure it's like, oh, I can't quite get it. There's also just the great thing of the pantomime of you as the reader watch John Carter in his adventures, and sometimes you're just yelling at him because he's finally caught Dejah Thoris and he's battling, but Dejah Thoris is of course behind him because, you know, he's got to protect her and he's the great fighter and she's the damsel in distress, and she's like, you're saying like, and he can hear noises, but he's got to focus on the fighting, and you as the audience are just like, John Carter, look behind you. And of course when he finally at the end of all the great epic battles looks behind him, Dejah Thoris has been snatched again, and he has to go after her again. And of course, by the end of the book, at about the middle of the book, we have her getting swept away on an airship. And then at the end of the thing, oh no, swept away on another airship. Will he capture her? Get to her in time? Will there be great stuff happening? I have to say, like, I actually enjoyed Fedor in this book because she is such the evil, cruel beauty, but at the end of the book she strangely has a kind of a switch in character, which I actually kind of enjoyed, and of course has a very over dramatic way of expressing this. It's like, you think there could have been kind of a lower level there that you could have, you know, you could have just found a nice fellow of your own and kind of settled down and raised some kids and just had a happy life, but no, you got to be dramatic. It's a pulp fiction novel. You got to be dramatic. I liked that Edgar Rice Burroughs is very aware of kind of switching his environments. It's almost a cinematic thing of like, you have George Lucas doing like, you know, the forest planet of Endor and having the ice planet of, is it Thoth? And I can see him looking at Edgar Rice Burroughs, who's got like, oh, he's got the hot Ecuador and he's got the cold thing. It's these very kind of primal hot, cold. It's like, this is kind of mirroring this like good, evil, you know, it's, we're going to have these very strong environments, which I can see is kind of echoed through our culture. So I, you know, great fun, great fun as always. I really really appreciate this. The Marsathon is fellows of it's Pints and Paperbacks, Paperback Junkie, Book Invasion, Richardson Reads, and of course Steve Donoghue are reading the 11 novels of Barsoom throughout the year 2020, and it's been just a lovely thing to have of just reading these fun light adventure stories with some interesting kind of interesting themes mixed in there. This was probably this was more the adventure story, I think, than other ones. I was less kind of picking apart sociological things, and I noticed racial politics, white anxiety and stuff like that still in there. And I mean, you know, at the end of this book, which I feel like this definitely does feel like the end of a trilogy. This is a standalone trilogy. You get this, which is 22 years before I'd been cast naked and a stranger into this strange and savage world. The hand of every race and nation was raised in continual strife and warring against the man of every other land and color. Today, by the might of my sword and the loyalty of the friends my sword had made for me, black man and white, red man and green, rub shoulders in peace and good fellowship. So it's Edgar Rice Burroughs is dealing in stereotype, in types and stuff like that, of like the proud warrior, the evil dastardly fellow. But he's also saying, and like, you know, all these kind of different, very kind of separate races with separate characteristics, but he's saying like, oh, John Carter, by the might of his sword, by banging their heads together, by destroying their gods, by disrupting their society, has brought them peace and stuff like that. We also have white savior stuff going on there, but you know, it definitely shows its kind of roots and kind of what, you know, kind of colonial adventure fiction before it. It's wonderful how you can trace stuff back, how much later science fiction and fantasy can be traced back to Edgar Rice Burroughs, and then how much Edgar Rice Burroughs can be traced back to H. Rider Haggard and all the kind of that kind of a tradition. So it's a continuum. And it's a valuable thing to kind of see it as that kind of continuum, and maybe how we are continuing to perpetrate or continue with that stuff, or not question that stuff today, or actually how we can value writers who do come up with different ideas about that stuff. And maybe we don't have John Carter of Virginia saving everybody by the end of a novel and reshaping the natives' culture. So I really enjoyed myself. Thank you. And you should definitely check out the videos. They all got together. Well, most of them got together for a kind of a live chat last month, and hopefully that will happen again this month. If I guess Steve, who's the always the ever constant presence on BookTube, can rally them back together again for another get together of discussing this novel and probably going off on tangents on Star Trek and how Steve's internet connection is doing this month, which is also very entertaining and fun. Is the point of any book club is you spend about 15% of the time actually talking about the book, and then the other 85% or 90% or 200% talking about Star Trek and other fun stuff, and just enjoying yourselves. And I really enjoyed watching that after I got home from work. So yes, that's all. More videos later.